Blackstone Audio presents The 20th Wife by Indu Sundaresan. For my parents, Group Captain R. Sundaresan and Madhuram Sundaresan, for all of who I am. Prologue. The wind howled and swept down, almost ripping the tent flap from its seams. Frigid air elbowed in, sending arctic fingers down warm napes, devouring the thin blue flames of the fire. The woman lying on the thin cotton mattress in one corner shivered. She clasped her arms around her protruding stomach and moaned, "Aya." The midwife rose slowly from her haunches, aged joints creaking, and hobbled to the entrance. She fastened the flap, came back to the woman, lifted the blanket, and peered between her legs. The woman winced as calloused, dirt-encrusted fingers prodded her. The Aya's thick face filled with satisfaction.
"It will not be long now."
The brazier in the corner flared to life as the midwife fanned the camel dung embers. The woman lay back, sweat cooling on her forehead, her face worn with pain. In a few minutes, another contraction swept her lower back. She clamped down on her lower lip to keep from crying out, not wanting them to worry outside the tent, unaware that the screeching gale swallowed even the loudest wail. Outside, an early night closed in on the campsite. Men huddled around a fire that sputtered and crackled as the wind lashed about their ears, kicking sand in their eyes and under their clothes, stinging their faces. A few tents, tattered and old, crowded in a tight circle at the edge of the desert, on the outskirts of Kandahar. Camels, horses, and sheep clustered around the camp, seeking warmth and cover from the storm. Gyasbeg broke away from the group around the fire, and picking his way past the animals, trudged to the tent where his wife lay. Barely visible in the flying sand, three children crouched against the flapping black canvas, arms around one another, eyes shut against the gale. Gyasbeg touched the shoulder of the elder boy.
"Muhammad,"
he yelled over the sound of the wind.
"Is your mother all right?"
The child raised his head and looked tearfully at his father.
"I don't know, Papa."
His voice was small, barely audible. Gyas had to lean over to hear him. Muhammad clutched at the hand on his shoulder.
"Oh, Baba, what will happen to us?"
Gyas knelt, drew Muhammad into his arms, and kissed the top of his forehead gently, his beard scratching the sand on Muhammad's hair. This was the first time he had shown any fear in all these days. He looked over the boy's head at his daughter.
"Saliha, go check on your Maji."
The little girl rose in silence and crawled inside the tent. As she entered, the woman looked up. She stretched out a hand to Saliha, who came immediately to her side.
"Papa wants to know if you are all right, Maji."
Asmat Begum tried to smile.
"Yes, Beta. Go tell Papa it will not be very long. Tell him not to worry. And you don't worry, all right, Beta?"
Saliha nodded and rose to leave. On impulse, she bent down again and hugged her mother tightly, burying her head in Asmat's shoulder. In her corner, the midwife clucked disapproval, rising as she spoke.
"No, no, don't touch your mother just before the baby is born. Now it will be a girl child because you are one. Run along now. Take your evil eye with you."
"Let her be, Aya,"
Asmat said weakly as the midwife hustled her daughter out. She said no more, unwilling to argue with the woman. Gyas raised an eyebrow at Saliha.
"Soon, Papa."
He nodded and turned away. Adjusting the cloth of the turban over his face, he wrapped his arms around his chest and walked away from the camp, head lowered against the shrieking wind. When he had reached the shelter of a large rock, he sat down heavily and buried his face in his hands. How could he have let matters come to this? Gyas's father, Muhammad Sharif, had been a courtier to Shah Tahmasp Safavi of Persia, and both Ghiyas and his older brother, Muhammad Tahir, had been well-educated as children. Brought up in an increasingly prosperous household, the children were happy growing up, moving from one posting to another. First to Khurasan, then to Yazd, and finally to Isfahan, where Muhammad Sharif had died the past year, 1576, as vizier of Isfahan. If things had remained at an even temper, Ghiyas would have continued his life as a nobleman with few cares, debts to tailors and wine merchants easily paid off every 2 or 3 months, and his hand open to those less fortunate. But this was not to be.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.